one and Youth Sunday. So we welcome you. We pray that you are blessed today by what we have to share with you. We pray that God is seen above all, and that God gets the glory out of everything that we do. So prepare our hearts and minds, and we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father God, for bringing us all on together. We thank you, Father God, for giving us the grace and the mercy, Father God, that you've always given us, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for forgiving us for our sins and allowing us, oh God, to be able to forgive others as you have forgiven us, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for all that you have put in us. We thank you, Father God, for the strength and for the courage, Father God. We thank you, God, for your fresh anointing. We ask, oh God, that you have your way, Father God. Let us minister to you, Father God, and let your presence, Father God, be felt, Father God, wherever anyone is, Father God, let your presence, Father God, fill that place, Father God, in Jesus' holy name we pray, amen, amen. So how many of you know that we serve a great God, a big God? God is good, God is so good, God is so good, and so we're going to praise him right now. If everyone could join me and praise, we're going to say how big God is. Hallelujah. 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 If you know God is big, let me hear you shout. Say hallelujah. Thank you, God. My God is big, so strong, so mighty, yeah. My God plans for me, go beyond the wildest dreams. My God is big, so strong,
so strong,
so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do.
There's nothing my God cannot do. Oh, there's nothing, yeah. Oh, there's nothing, yeah. Oh, there's nothing God can do. Oh, believe in your heart. If you know he's a big God, let me hear you say it now. Woo! Yeah. And if you still make your way, lift your appraisal. Oh, what a mighty, mighty, mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. My God is big. So strong. So mighty. My God, his plans for me, yeah, go beyond. Hallelujah, 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 yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for being big in our lives. Thank you, God, for reigning above all names, God. We thank you, God. We glorify you, God. We love you, God. In Jesus' holy name, thank you, God. Lord, you're mighty, God. You are so mighty, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome again to Life Builders Church. We are so glad to have you all. We're so glad and excited that it's Youth Sunday and that we are representing for all of the LBC youth, those that are physically with us and those that are away. So we truly just want to just say welcome. We're so excited that you all are here with us today. On behalf of our bishop and our first lady, we want to say welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We truly are glad that you are with us this morning. And we want you to get excited with us as we're celebrating and as we are excited about this fifth Sunday. Encourage us and worship with us and intercede for us. We want to bring God's glory, oh God, forward. And we want you all to be with us. We want you all to worship with us. We want you to pray with us. We want you to read your word with us. So encourage us and just stand in agreement with us, because we know that God is our source and God is everything that we need. Even at our age, at a young age, we want our children to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and we want them to know who Jesus is. So it's a joy and a pleasure to be before you this morning leading praise and worship. If we could all just bow our heads this morning, we're going to go into a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We just first give you all glory, honor, and praise, oh God. We truly bless you and we thank you. We thank you for being our God. We thank you for being our Lord. We thank you for being a big God, a strong God, a God that can do anything but fail. We truly bless you this morning, and you're worthy of all of our praise. We thank you this morning, oh God, because we know that this worship, we will not leave the same way that we came, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for your spirit being poured out. We thank you, oh God, for your presence that's going to flow through us. And we thank you, oh God, for the excitement and the joy that we have in our hearts. We thank you for every person that's on this line with us today, oh God, in this virtual platform, oh God. No matter what means that they are here, oh God, we thank you that you allow them to be in our presence this morning, oh God. And we pray, oh God, that their ears would be receptive to what we have to say, and that their hearts and their minds would be open, oh God, to what you have to say to them, oh God. So we continue to give you praise. We continue to give you glory. And we thank you for all of our youth, oh God. We thank you for how you're ministering to them, oh God. We thank you for how you're using them in a strong and a mighty way, oh God. You're encouraging them to be brave, oh God, to be brave, young, fearless Christians that are about your work and about your kingdom. So we give you all the praise and we give you all the glory and we give you all the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Good morning again, LBC. It's such a privilege to be before you this morning. I'm going to read a scripture before you, and it comes from the New King James Version, and it's Romans I'm sorry, it comes from Romans, the New King James Version, and it's verses 11 through 17. And the New King James Version states, "First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit and the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing, I make mention of you always in my prayers, making requests if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey. For by the will of God to come unto you, for I long to see you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end you may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith bond of you and me. Now I would not have you be ignorant, for sometimes I purpose to come into you, that I might have some fruit among you and among other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and the barbarians. So as much as in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are also in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God into salvation to everyone that believeth. For therein the righteousness of God be revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." So we thank you this morning for joining us and hearing a powerful word. And we are not ashamed to preach the word of God. We're not ashamed to let the gospel be spoken amongst LBC youth. And so now we're going to go to our declaration. We want to declare over our church and we want to declare over our youth. We want to declare over you this morning. So join with me as we say our declaration for Life Builders Church. All right, let's say it loud and proud. Life Builders Church is a church and ministry focused on the agenda of the kingdom of God. We are corporately called to transform lives and build people to know their purpose and take their place as productive and purpose-filled citizens of the kingdom of God. We have God's mandate. We have all necessary components in place, inclusive of power, provision, personnel, and people. We have everything we need. Let's say that again. We have everything we need. One more time. We have everything we need. We have all that God ordained for us to have, possess, and obtain for his purpose. We are a stable house with longevity. We are relevant. We are vibrant and fresh. We walk in agreement with God's agenda and plan for this house and impact this generation for his glory. 2021 is our year to recover all and progress forward. Amen, 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 amen. And now we will finish up our praise and worship with another one of our youth members. So stand in agreement with him and encourage him and worship with him, because we want you all to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen, amen.
Lord, you're mighty.
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 Say, Lord, you're mighty.
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 Yes, he's mighty. Say, Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Oh, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Yes, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Say, Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty. Oh, Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. When I think of all you made, the sun, the moon, and the stars, no praise is high enough to express how great you are. God, we mighty God we serve, yes, mighty God we serve. Let angels bow before the mighty God we serve. What a mighty God, mighty God we serve, yes. Let angels bow before the mighty God we serve. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Say all glory, all honor, all praise, all praise. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Say all glory, all honor, all praise, all praise to the mighty God we. Mighty God we serve, yes, mighty God we serve. Let heavens and earth adore the mighty God we serve. Lord the mighty, Lord the mighty, Lord the mighty, Lord the mighty. Say, Lord the mighty, all is mighty, yes, the mighty, Lord the mighty. Say, Lord the mighty, 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 say, Lord the mighty. Say, Lord, you're 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 mighty.
Amen, amen, amen. Awesome job, Ty. We are so proud of you. And we could not agree more that our Lord is mighty and he is strong. So we are just so happy. Amen, amen, and amen. All right, we have come to that point in our worship where it's time for our word. So we want to encourage you to get your pen and your pad and let's lead into worship. The next voice that you will hear after we have an introduction, the next voice that you will hear will be our speaker. So let's prepare our hearts and prepare our minds to receive the word. But we have a special treat for you before the word comes. So sit back and enjoy. And we want you to engage with us. We want you to encourage us and intercede for us during this time. Okay? Amen.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop, never stop working. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I'm so grateful that you, God, have influence over my life, over my family's life, over my business, over my friends. God, we thank you, God, that you never stop working. We thank you, God, that even when we don't see it, even when we don't feel it, God, you always there. You always with us. You always direct us and guide us. You're always speaking to us. You're always listening to us, God. And we just thank you that we may recognize your voice and your influence in everything that we do, everything that we have, everything that we're looking forward to, everything that we've experienced in our past. Lord God, help us, Father God, to learn from you and learn what you ultimately want us to learn in everything. Lord God, we thank you, Father God, for your fresh anointing. Lord God, anoint us, oh God, from our heads to our toes, Father God. Speak through me, God, that no one see me, but they see and hear all of you, God. Have your way, God, because you never stop working, and we know that we have faith in you, God. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. So let's get to it. God has given me a word. I have a word from the Lord. It has definitely been a journey, really, to bring this word to you today. But the journey has been great, and the journey for me was learning how to hear clearly from God. You know, a lot of you know me. You know, I grew up in church, and I worshiped, I danced, I've sang, I've, you know, done all of these things. But one of the challenges for me was really hearing the voice of God. And it was a challenge because, you know, sometimes growing up in church, you hear people say things like, oh, well, you know, they just always saying God said, and, you know, and kind of dismissing that. But in maturity, if God says something, no one else should have to understand or justify that, because God said it and it is what it is. And so in maturity, we must understand that if God says to someone to do something, even if we didn't hear it, we must be obedient and take heed to the instruction that the servant of the Lord has been given. And so today we're going to focus in the text of Exodus 8. And we will start from there. So I actually had something so special for y'all, but the enemy has been on attack, and so we will let him get no glory. So I'm gonna just read it to you all. But I wanted to focus on the first part of this particular passage, and I wanted to focus on that because God wants to be the head of our lives, right? We know that. Like, so with God being the head of our lives, we must seek him in order to be directed and to move forward. And so, Pranica, if you could just skip two slides, please, because it was actually supposed to be story time, but
the video didn't play the way that we wanted to. And so God is still good. We're going to move on. But when seeking God is from God, we must tap into the word. And so when applying the word, sometimes it can be simple. Sometimes it can be followed verbatim. But sometimes we must do some research and get context to gain understanding. That's still okay. Like, don't be discouraged if you're reading the word and you're like, I don't know who they're talking to. I don't really understand this verbiage. You know, what's going on? We have Google. You can Google it and, you know, you can tell when there's a trusted source, but really all you need to know is what was happening here, right? So ask God to give you wisdom to apply it to your specific day. But when it's hard, just keep going, like press forward, because that's God in that pressing. And so back to Exodus 8, we can go to the next slide. Thank you. Back to Exodus 8, we're going to focus on verses 1 through 15, and I'll read that to you. These are the names, because God is good. Okay. Then the Lord said to Moses, go unto Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will plague all of your country with frogs. The Nile shall swarm with frogs, and that shall come up into your house and into your bedroom and onto your bed and onto the houses of your servants and your people, into your ovens, into your kneading bowls. The frogs shall come up on you and on your people and all your servants. And the Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand with your staff over the rivers, over the canals, over the pools, and make the frogs come up on the land of Egypt. So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. But the magicians did the same by their secret arts, and the made frogs come up the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron and said, plead with the Lord to take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go to sacrifice to the Lord. Moses said to Pharaoh, be pleased to command me when I am to plead for you and for the servants of your people, that the frogs be cut off from you and your houses and be left only in the Nile. And he said, tomorrow, Moses said, be it as you say, so that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God. The frogs shall go away from you and your houses and your service and your people. They shall be left only in the Nile. So Moses and Aaron went. So Moses and Aaron went forth from Pharaoh, and Moses cried to the Lord about the frogs as he had agreed. And the Lord did according to the word of Moses, and the frogs died out in the houses and the courtyards and in the fields. And they gathered them into heaps, and the land stank. But then Pharaoh saw that there was a respite, and he hardened his heart and would not listen to them as the Lord said. And so I'm gonna go back to 13 through 15, because this is important. So it says, and the Lord did according to the word of Moses, and the frogs died out in the houses and the courtyards and the fields, and they gathered them in heaps, and the land stank. But when Pharaoh saw that there was a respite, and he hardened his heart and would not listen to them as the Lord had said. And so, Chronicle, if you could go back to the frog slide for me, that would be great. But this is one of those context things. And so I'm going to bring up a context fact here. In this particular time, Egyptians idolized frogs. And so there was a Egyptian god of frogs named Hekwit. And that's, you know, who they worshiped. God sent the plague of frogs on purpose because that was their idol. You know, a lot of times we idolize and we put things above God, and God literally just be reaching out to us, be like, no, y'all, that's not it. That's not it. And so in this moment, he was saying that same thing, like, that's not it. And so the reason why I had to read back to 13 through 15 was because I thought it was pretty funny, because God really has a sense of humor. And so not only did he send the frogs to plague the land so that they could understand that they were not God, once he took them away, he didn't just whisk them away. They died and they had to gather them in heaps, and it made the land stink. Not only did they die, but then they had to sit there and stink and probably wither away. But I could only imagine that was horrible. But what made it worse when the plague came anyway was that magicians were present at the time, and people had more faith, especially the Egyptian people, had more faith in the magicians to do God's work than God. And so unfortunately, when you have more faith in other things than God, God has to show you that he is supreme. So this is what happened with them in this particular instance. And so because they used magic, because they did all these things, God still had to show himself strong. And so, yes, Pharaoh eventually humbled himself and he asked Moses and Aaron to go pray and sacrifice. And the verbiage was crazy, because he's like, go sacrifice to your God. He still knew that he wasn't going to serve God, even just in the intent of what he said. Like, it was go sacrifice to your God, take this away from me. But he knew in his heart he wasn't necessarily going to do what God asked him to do and let his people go so that they may serve him, right? So I love the fact that when Pharaoh came to Moses, that Moses didn't shun him. Moses didn't forbid him. Moses confidently responded and was like, okay, but the mandate, pretty much the mandate from God, has not changed. He gave him, he laid out his specific prayer approach. He said, you know, I'm going to ask God to remove these and that they only be in the Nile. He gave him, you know, pretty much what he was going to do. He gave him kind of like a precept of what he should have been praying. You know what I mean? And so it was great. God delivered, but man didn't. And God knew that, because God could have totally whisked those frogs away and they didn't have to deal with the stink in the land. But I think that was a part of God's plan, because he knew that Pharaoh's heart was going to harden again. But here's where this sequence begins to help us to start looking to applying the word to our lives. And we can go to the next slide. Thank you. We can't afford to forget about God. Nothing or no one can take God's place. We should know that. We should have confidence in that. And our life should totally represent that. We put importance in so many things. We put importance on our family, being a mom. Like, you know, children are very important to me, because I feel like, you know, I got to make all these decisions for them and they can't make them themselves. And if I don't do it, or if Kevin doesn't do it, it might not get done. And, you know, all those things. We tend to be so controlling that we forget God is actually in control. And so we can't forget that. We know that in the end, victory and protection is only available by your connection to God through Jesus Christ and your genuine repentance. We must consistently repent. There are times that God is not pleased with what we do, and we had no idea we were even in the wrong. And so with that being said, we have to consistently have a heart of repentance. And so we're going to go to the next slide. So today I'm here to tell you, you need God, and he's in you. The Holy Spirit is already in you. His influence is already in you. You need God. So if you forgot, if you didn't think so, you need God. Also, God needs your influence here on earth. We as Christians have allowed the world to silence our voice, and it's not okay. God's word should move us. We should be strong and courageous in everything and be righteous. Like we should, like that's the bare minimum for us to live a fulfilled life. But why do we choose evil? Like why do we choose to be disobedient? Why do we choose to go off the path? Because we got free will, you know, we get free will and it's like, oh, I'm gonna dip my toe in this and I'm gonna come back. But all these things are so important to remember when being obedient and following the will of God and the instruction of God, because if we know that we need God and we know that he's in us, we know that God needs our influence on earth, we know that God's word should move us, we know that we should be strong and courageous and righteous, and we don't feel just that in that moment, We should be reaching. We should be asking God, like, God, help me because I'm weak in this moment. God, help me because I don't have any courage or I'm insecure in this moment. God, help me. And sometimes our prayer life suffers because we don't read the word. So let's go to the next slide. I'm not going to crack the whip too hard, but let's get to the word. So the word consistently tells us to be strong and courageous. And I Chronicle, could you go back one more, please? I'm gonna start with Joshua because the Lord laid these two verses on my spirit this morning. And it was just further confirmation that I still didn't see all the many verses that God laid on man's heart to tell us to be strong and courageous. And so today I'm going to start with Joshua 1, verses 7 and 8. And so Joshua 1, verses 7 and 8 reads, "Above all, be strong and very courageous to observe carefully the whole instruction my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from the right or the left so that you will have success wherever you go. This book of instruction must not depart from your mouth. You are to meditate on it day and night so that you may carefully observe everything written in it. For when you will prosper and succeed, for then you will prosper and succeed in whatever you do." And so that's just further confirmation that when you live a life filled with the word, or you live a life seeking the word, everything that you do will prosper and be in full success. And on a personal level, like I didn't understand that impact. I always knew that, you know, God favored me, and I always knew that I was a child of God. I always tried to apply whatever verses, you know, that were memory verses or something that I could say verbatim. But did I know that that was the key to my success right away? No, I didn't. I had no idea that that was the key to my success. However, once I did realize that staying connected to God was the key to my success, oh, now you can't tell me nothing. I'm calling God. Like, yeah, no man can tell me anything. I'm calling God. All right, Chronicle, let's get back to what we had on the slideshow. Psalm 27, I wanted to give y'all a little bit of imagery because I feel like sometimes when we get a message that invokes us to change or grow, sometimes it's a little hard. Like it was hard for me. I felt like it was a lot of ground to cover. And God was like, so like, I got you. Like, it is what it is. You got to do this. This is what I gave you. You want to share this with the people. I'm like, okay, God, all right. But I wanted to give y'all kind of like a cool way to display some of these Bible verses, just in the same way some of you all follow me online. So just in the same way that I might share some of them. So Psalm 27 and 14 says, "Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord." And so I wanted to focus on this verse in particular because we must focus on God in waiting. There are a lot of things that we must seek the face of God for, and we must wait for. We have to be prepared for things that God has given us. We have to, we have to be prepared. And so in order to be prepared, we have to be strong and courageous in our preparation. We have to. If we are weak, if we are discouraged, if we are insecure, we might miss it. And so let's not miss it. All right, let's go to the next verse. We're still staying on the topic of being strong and courageous because it's necessary, and I want you all to keep it. So screenshot it. Do what you need to do, but be strong and courageous is where we are right now, okay? But we're using the word, we're applying that, being strong and courageous. So we're using the word and applying that to this particular thing. So 2 Chronicles 15 and 7 says, "But you take courage. Don't let your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded." And so we always quote the verse, don't be weary in well-doing. But a lot of times we still be weary and well-doing, like just in flesh, like, you know, we being honest in flesh, we're weak and well-doing. Sometimes we're upset. Sometimes we think people are taking advantage of us and everything, but God says, let the weak say, "I am strong." When you're feeling weak, take courage. When you're feeling weak, reach out. You might just have to just crack the book open and see what God gives you, you know? But when you're feeling weak, don't succumb to that weakness, and don't succumb to depression. Don't succumb to a mentality that you're less than, because you're not. You're going to be victorious in that situation, and you should know that, and you should take courage in that, because guess what? All of your hard work, it will be rewarded. It says it in the word. It says it right there. And so we're going to move on to the next verse, which is 1 Samuel 4 and 9. And it says, "Take courage and be men, O Philistines, lest you become slaves to the Hebrews as they have been to you. Be men and fight." And so God gave me this one because we have to be strong and courageous in order to avoid bondage. Slaves don't look the same in 2021, but there is still bondage happening in the spirit, in the physical, in the natural. And so we have to take courage in God and have faith in God and be strong in God so that we don't fall short, and so that we don't get taken advantage of, and so that we don't fall into bondage. We have to be saved in that matter. We cannot allow our spirits to be so weak that we allow ourselves to take on things that aren't of God. Okay? God, I thank you for this word. I thank you for this word. But we have to be strong in our faith. Bondage is not of God. Bondage is of the enemy. And I'm going to leave it there, and I'm going to let you pray about that. But pray that everything that you do in your daily life, that you are avoiding bondage in Christ. So we'll move on to the next verse. And so Psalm 31, 24 says, "Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord." And so this one is actually Another verse that you can use in waiting, but also I use this verse in decision making. Everybody who knows me closely, especially everyone who knows me in business, knows that I have a ton of ideas. I mean, like, if you pick up any journal, it might be a prayer, it might be an idea, it might be a product list, it might be, I mean, it's a bunch of things that, you know, I have a ton of ideas. But one thing about me is that I'm not about to jump out there if I don't feel like I'm prepared, right? It just doesn't feel right to me. It's one of those orderly things. Like, sometimes we just gotta do it. Like, you know, I do know how to roll with the punches, but if I can, I am gonna wait. And so I had a conversation with a friend and we were talking about how the difference between them and I, and that they just jump and do stuff. And I'm like, well, I just can't. But I realized that even in my reservations and even in what seems to be procrastination in the worldview, I have to give it to God, because ultimately God has the final say in whatever I put out there. And I don't want to be a poor representation of him. And I also don't want to waste my time. Like, I've had successful businesses and I've had failed businesses as well. And so with a failed business, it's like, you know, it's a fear that you might fail again. But if you've done it before, it's not the same fear as if you've not done it before. All of that being said, it's important to still wait on the Lord. And so in decision making, you must wait on the Lord and be strong and have courage, even when you feel like the delay is so long, even when you feel like your prayers aren't being answered, even when you feel like all things are going wrong, just know that your steps are ordered, and just know that when you officially wait on the Lord and you actively wait on the Lord, you will find success in that. And so we can go to the next verse. Thank you. So what do I do when I'm being tested? So I had to make y'all laugh, because y'all know I'm a little bit silly and I can't be super, super serious, so it's not gonna be me. But Romans 12:12, and IMOW is in my own words. I put this in my own words. And so during a test, I will just discern what is the will of God, period, right? Period. But I do this, so this is the action right here. I do this by not conforming to the world and transforming my mind. So we'll just go to the next slide, because I explain that a little bit further. But we have to get some context before that. So we have to remember not to get caught up. That's, you know, not being conformed to the world, and transforming and renewing our mind is important in not getting caught up. Sometimes we get caught up just because, you know, we're in a whirlwind of things and the whole world is moving this way. And so we just have to fall in line, but that's not the case. Nowhere in the word does it tell believers to fall in line with the world. It's just not possible when you have faith in God. You can't fall in line. You have to be separate. And so in being separate, you have to recognize and discern when things aren't of God, and you have to make sure that you don't get caught up. I got some stories where I got caught up. And I know for sure that that was God's hand, and that was God telling me you wasn't supposed to be there, or you were supposed to be doing that, or I told you so, right? And so following trends and group of people who don't have God in their heart, it can cost us big. I thank God that, you know, the things that I have experienced and the trouble that I have gone through, it didn't stop my progress and my success, but it could have. And so it's important to remember that your groups of friends, you better be testing them by faith, and you better be testing that they know God, and that you all are following God together, because you all can mutually encourage each other. And so let's go to Romans 1, verses 21. And I was so grateful to see God be moving. I was so grateful that Ashley started in Romans today, because I'm telling y'all, I was about to give y'all the whole Romans, but the playback wasn't working out. So y'all ain't get the whole Romans, but y'all was about to get Romans, maybe 1 through 3. Because I want y'all to, matter of fact, write that down. Romans 1 through 3. I want y'all to read those three chapters. They were so helpful in discerning things in 2021 for me. But we'll focus on verses 21 through 32 right now, because we want to recognize some things and we want to start discerning things. And so 21 says, "For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worship and serve the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind and to do what ought not be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, and malice. They were full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They were gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them." And so, I mean, if this doesn't sound like now to y'all, I'm gonna need y'all to pray for discernment and for some focus, because God has always spoken to us, and God is speaking specifically all the time, but are we listening? God doesn't want us to get caught up in the things of the world, and I know sometimes it hurts, and I know sometimes it feels uncomfortable to disagree with the general public or, you know, with the masses of people, but it's important for us to do that if we're going to be set apart. But I really didn't want to, you know, go heavy on the, like, cracking the whip on how you should treat your people, like, that the people that you know that are evil. Like, I don't want you to feel like you have to shun them or, you know, rebuke them or condemn them, because if you go to the next verse in Romans 2, Paul goes to say that, "Judge not, lest you be judged in the same manner that you judge." And so we're not judging them. We're not judging people who don't have God in their hearts, but we must humble ourselves and have humility in our heart for them, so that we may share the truth with them, and so that the truth will remain and reign powerful over the powerless. People right now are hurting. People right now are seeking truth. We are in a generation of information and knowledge. People are seeking protection. People are seeking everything that God is, but they're looking in the universe, which is a creation and not the creator. They're looking into sorcery, which is not of God. It's all of evil intent. And so when they're looking at all of these places, they're not going to find God. And they're going to grow more and more evil because they're constantly searching for to fill a void. And that void can only be filled by God. And so we must be the example, and we must show them how to advance. And so we can go to the next slide. So Luke 11 and 1 was a good like turning point for me here. And it's because we have to learn how to focus on prayer. All of you know, a lot of us are prayer warriors. We done prayed about 4 times before we got here. And that is because we love God. We want to talk to God. And we love talking to God. It's a privilege to be able to talk to God. So we're going to talk to him as much as we want to. But in Luke 11, 1, the disciples reached out to Jesus and was like, man, you know, you live in that quiet place. And once you finish, like, we kind of want to learn how to pray like how you pray. Teach us how to pray like John taught his disciples. And so the John they're talking about is John the Baptist. But I thought this was really good because I think that in order for us to be intentional leaders and intentional leaders is actually a quote that I got from Bishop, but in order for us to be intentional leaders, we have to focus on praying, what the word means for us, and growing forward unified as a community and as Christ-led people. But we have to have that intent. Like, we have to want it. We have to seek it. We have to consistently seek it. Sometimes we don't consistently seek godly relationships. We don't consistently seek godly influence on our daily activities. But it was so cool that we got to see the vulnerability in the disciples as they were following him. They had watched him. They had witnessed him do things, but they're still like, look, I want to know how you do that. Like, I want to know how you pray. Like, you talking, I know you talking directly to God. So how do you do that? People today are asking us that. And can we tell them? Do we have an outline, or do we have a basis or a precept that we can just say, like, all right, here's how you pray. You know, do we do that? I mean, if somebody come to you today and they're like, I just don't know, what do you do? So let's figure out what we can do. Let's go to the next slide. Thank you. So what does an intentional leader do? How do you live your life? Well, you get to know people in a genuine manner. People like to know that when they talk to you, you hear them. People like to also know that when they talk to you, you hear God. People are, even though they're not saying it with their words, they are yearning for God's presence to show up in their lives. They're curious, you know, they want to know. And so we must, you know, be genuine to people and get to know people, but we also must exercise discernment because there also are people who have evil in their heart, and we must make sure that we resist the enemy so that he can flee from us. But we can be wise in that. And we also have to make sure that when we're getting to know people, sometimes being what the world calls an empath, or, you know, compassionate, or wanting to, not necessarily wanting to take on other people's energy, but sometimes you do. We also must understand that we must not be consumed by other people's things and other people's mess, so that we can reach to God and give it to God and let him influence that thing, and, you know, not be ours. Mm-hmm. An intentional leader also has confidence when things change. There's a level of anxiousness that happens in our flesh when plans change, like we want to control things so much when plans change, it's like, but when things change, we must still remember to believe in God. And so if we're strong and courageous in Christ, we have confidence that when things change, God is moving still. God is going to continue to move. So it's okay. An intentional leader also is patient. We talked about that earlier, but really God's timing is perfect. You know, sometimes we compare ourselves to what other people are doing and to other people's imaginary timeline from social media without considering all of the work that people put into what they're actually putting out there, that product that they're actually putting out. And so we must do the work and sow the seeds, but be patient enough to be in position to see or reap the harvest. Like, I think about this all the time now, in sowing seed of the word and, you know, and talking to customers and just people on a day-to-day, like, farmers don't get a harvest immediately. So why do we feel like after we just drop the word off to somebody that immediately their lives are going to change? That's not okay. Be patient with people when you are, you know, ministering to them, when you are trying to teach them the word. It's okay. It's okay to be patient. It's okay to still encourage them when you don't understand why they're, you know, why it's not clicking. It's okay. It's okay. The next step is to be encouraging and motivational. And so that's why I kind of start with the being patient, because encouragement and motivation, it helps heal and it helps to invoke growth in people, and it helps to strengthen you. Like, just I can't really put it in words, but the word of God says it best: iron sharpens iron. And sometimes, you know, we get dull. Sometimes we there are situations that happen in our lives and we don't understand. And so we must be with other believers who can encourage and who can motivate us to keep going and to be strong and courageous and to live by the word. Sometimes our flesh, and sometimes it's just not enough. Like, sometimes we are, you know, in those instances where we are feeling weak, where anxiety is trying to step in, or when depression is trying to step in, we must know that we are overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And so even in our weakness, we can encourage and motivate others, and it will bring us forth healing. I know that for a fact. And it's crazy, God. I know. He wants me to tell you all this. It's been hard for me to talk about it online, but in person, I've been talking about it the whole year. And so this is it. And I guess on the last day of infant and pregnancy loss awareness month, it's fitting. But in January, I lost a child, and it was hard, and I'm not gonna cry because I'm healed, but it was hard because of many things. We weren't planning to, you know, have another child, but we trusted God, you know, in that. And we were like, okay, God, you know, it's your plan, you know, whatever you want for our lives, we're here, right? And so when we got the news that his heartbeat had stopped, we were like, what? So, you know, of course, immediately I cried. I'm like, oh my gosh, y'all know I'm a crybaby. Y'all know me. And so, but the first thing that came out of our mouths was, God does not make mistakes, right? And so we encouraged each other in that moment. Like it was God was in the room. And so, you know, going through it all, I had to, you know, deliver a stillborn and I had to experience all of that. And it was rough, but my healing, it came from telling people about it. Immediately when I went back to work, I don't know why I was inclined to just tell random people about it. I had new clients and one of my new clients, I was like, girl, I don't know why I'm inclined to tell you this, but I lost a baby earlier this month. And, you know, I shared my story and she was like, wow. She was like, you know, I don't even know how you had the courage to even talk about it so soon. Like, you know, it's very fresh. And she's like, you know, well, I experienced the same thing. And I was like, really? And she was like, yeah. She was like, well, it's not the exact same thing, but I experienced loss in a tremendous way prior to conceiving. And so her story was similar, but kind of the opposite. Like, I had two healthy children and, you know, the third wasn't, you know, it didn't end that way, but hers was the opposite. And so her testimony encouraged me because it was like, wow, like, you were so strong to keep going and keep trying that you did, you know, end up with a reward at the end, and you do have a healthy baby. And I'm so thankful, you know, for your story and that you can encourage me in the moment, right? But that probably was one of the first times that I shared it, but I knew that I had to keep sharing. And so as people were coming in, they're like, oh my gosh, you had the baby. And, you know, and people are excited and people were like, oh my gosh, yes, look at you. And I had to break it to them. Like, well, yes, I had the baby, but he didn't survive. And it was like, everybody broke down like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And they felt, you know, immediately they felt pity for me. And I didn't want pity. I didn't want people to feel sorry for us because we knew that God still had his hand on us and he still had his hand on the situation. And so now I know that God was still blessing us and God just wanted us to trust him in that moment. And you know, sometimes we can be selfish in our prayers. And, you know, I could have very well, you know, went into prayer and was like, you know, God, I'm expecting a miracle. Because, of course, once they told me that his heartbeat stopped, I didn't immediately deliver. I had to still go through the whole delivery process. And so I could have selfishly prayed and been like, God, I'm expecting a miracle. And, you know, I know that you will wake him up, but that wasn't in God's plan. And so we trusted God and we prayed, but we prayed that his will be done and not that my will be done, but his will be done. And so that was, you know, the outcome of that pregnancy, but the greater in purpose came right after that. It came in me sharing my testimony. It came in me being transparent and it came in me still trusting God. But I say that to say, encourage people, motivate people, use your testimony to overcome and to heal, because it is so important in these times to show people how God helps you heal. People are hurting. People are suffering, but God will bring you out. And so next, an intentional leader is knowledgeable and wise. In this time of information, people are looking to learn things. People are looking to find out things. And if you're an intentional leader in Christ, you're knowledgeable and you're wise about the word of God, right? And so if we're knowledgeable and we're wise about the word of God, guess what book our nose is in all the time? The Bible. Like, we have to learn the Bible. And a lot of times I joke with some of my customers about it, but so I feel like we're at a separation in the church, right? Where there were a generation before us that loved to memorize things. They could tell you exactly where to find the Bible verses and they can quote that scripture to you, right? But unfortunately, a lot of the church hurt came from people who knew people who could do that, but then at home, they weren't actually living by it, right? Or, you know, in their experiences, there were some things that kind of put them off that was like, yeah, you might quote the word, but you're not, you know, not necessarily, you know, living by it or whatever. But if we learn to apply the word, if we learn to use the word and actually live by it, so, you know, being transformed by the renewing of our mind, consistently renewing our mind, consistently reflecting, consistently seeing what God has for us and what God gives us, then we can be knowledgeable and wise, and we can avoid, you know, misconceptions or judgment from other people, right? So we must make sure that we get into the word and we actually use the word. The word is so relevant. The word is so important for us to live by. The word will encourage us. The word will make us laugh. The word will give us juicy love stories. The word has so much depth in there. But if we don't have any intent to get in there, how can we have some impact on this generation or this world? How can we be separate if all we're taking in is worldly things and no godly things, right? So the next, that takes me to the next intentional leader trait is being teachable. So we don't know everything. God is all knowing. None of us are all-knowing. So even when we are teaching people, even when we are instructing people, we must remember that we are still learning. So I remember this, and I will never forget this from our discipleship training from like 10 years ago. Bishop said, in being a disciple, it's okay if you don't know something. It's okay for you to say, you know what, let me get back to you about that because I'm gonna do my research and then we're gonna move further with this conversation. We're gonna be challenged as believers and we're gonna be asked questions that we might not know the answers to. But we also must humble ourselves and become teachable in that moment and say, well, let's research it together, or let me do some research and let me get back to you because that's a good point. And I just really don't know how to answer it. So I'm gonna go before God. That example right there shows your maturity and shows that you value the information that you give to people, and you're not just going to give them any old thing. You don't, God is not interested in the any old thing. Like, God is interested in our focus, and God is interested in our hearts. And if we go after God in our hearts and in our focus, all things will, you know, will line up. And so being teachable is important. No one should devalue anyone's word or anyone's worth. We all should find ways to learn from each other, and being teachable is so important as a trait, being an intentional leader. So the next trait of being an intentional leader is something that's one of my favorites, being fun. In leadership, we learn that there are people who respond to different things, and being fun is important for some people in order to engage them, in order to keep them focused, in order to make it interesting. And so when you are being an intentional leader, when you have something that you
Amen, amen, amen. As we are waiting on Sister Charisse to come back, we know that her word was just so good that the enemy was trying to creep in, and she was delivering a powerful word. And we are just so thankful because we got part of that message, and we know that God has more for us. We are not discouraged, because we know that the enemy tries to come in when he knows that God's work is being done, when he knows that there is a message that is being delivered to his people, when he knows that there is a word that's coming forth that's going to change the lives of people, when he knows that God is building up intentional leaders and giving them the characteristics and the traits that he wants. The enemy tries to come in and he tries to create tactics and ways to steal and kill and destroy. But we come against that in the name of Jesus. There's no amount of technology or no amount of interruption or anything that can stop what God has for his people. So join with me in giving Sister Charisse a wonderful round of applause and accolades for her message and her testimony and just her powerful word this morning. We're not going to be defeated because of technical issues, or we're not going to be interrupted from what God's plan for us is today because of technical issues. But join me in applauding her for being brave and courageous and being intentional about getting her message across, because I receive it today. I'm glad about what God has for us. I'm glad about the message that she brought forth. And we are so thankful, Sister Charisse, and we know that you'll be joining us back in a second, but we are so thankful that God used you, and God used you mightily for your word. So give her her accolades, and let's bless God in this house, because we are all going to be intentional leaders. We are going to be intentional leaders, even at our age, at the young age, for the youth and young adults. We are going to be intentional leaders, and God made us strong. He made us victorious. He made us all these things. So in spite of the technical interruptions, in spite of the enemy trying to creep in, we are victorious, and we're coming out stronger. We're coming out better. We're coming out greater. We're coming out any and every way that the Lord has for us. So we thank God for that word that came forth. We thank God that even though the enemy tried to creep in, that God is still in control. And just like when she gave her testimony, God used her. God used her in a mighty way. Used her, oh God, to tell people about what she's been through, and to use that and bless others. So we thank you right now, God. We lift our hands and we say thank you. We say hallelujah because you're worthy. Hallelujah because you get all the glory. Hallelujah because you're mighty. Hallelujah, because you're greater and stronger and bigger than anything that the enemy could try to do. And we rebuke it right now in the name of Jesus. We put him under our feet because he has no place here. We put him behind us, oh God, because he can't touch your glory. We give you all praise because you truly are worthy of being the omnipotent, powerful God that you are. And we bless you. We bless you in this house today, oh God. We glorify you and magnify you. Don't let me worship by myself. We give you all praise, glory. We give you all praise and honor because you're worthy, oh God. We thank you for the powerful testimony. We thank you for the powerful word. We thank you, oh God, that is touching people all across this nation in the name of Jesus. You be glorified today. You be magnified, oh God. Pour out your spirit and let us receive it in the name of Jesus. We thank you for giving us the gifts, the talents, oh God. We thank you for giving us the characteristics of being an intentional leader, oh God. We thank you, oh God, because you said in your word, we need you. And the world needs you more than ever right now. So we bless you today, God. We worship you. We give you glory and honor, oh God. We can't stop praising you for how you've kept us, how you've delivered us, how you've put the things in the atmosphere for us to receive. So we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. And whatever it is that you need, it's in the atmosphere right now. So grab it. Don't be shy and don't be bashful, but grab it. If it's healing that you need, it's in the atmosphere. If it's deliverance that you need, it's in the atmosphere. If it's prayer that you need, it's in the atmosphere. If it's breakthrough that you need, it's in the atmosphere. So we thank you right now, God. You truly are worthy to be praised. We bless you this morning, God. We glorify you and we thank you and we honor you today. So give God some praise this morning because he's worthy. He's so worthy this morning. He's worthy to be praised. We bless you, God. We glorify you and we thank you. Even in the midst of a powerful word that he can't be stopped, he can't be interrupted. The enemy has no place. And there's nothing that anybody or anyone can try to do that will stop God from doing what he's supposed to do. So we thank you this morning, God. We bless you. We honor you and we glorify you. And I say that to say, if there's anyone here who does not know Jesus, we want you to know Jesus. We want you to be saved. We want you to be in our family. We want you to be in our kingdom. We want you to be in God's kingdom. And we ask right now, if you don't know Jesus and if you're not saved, we have the ABCs of salvation for you. First, you have to admit that you are a sinner. And the word says in Romans 3:23, and this has stuck with me since I was a little girl, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so we invite you to now believe that the Lord is your Savior. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. It says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And because of that, we now have direct communication and relationship with God, and we have access to his kingdom. And now we want you to commit. We want you to commit to being a believer in Christ. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved according to Romans 10:9. So for those that were not saved, we invite you and we welcome you and we say congratulations. Welcome to the kingdom of God. You are now a part of our family and we are so excited to have you. And we are glad that you are in the place with us today. We thank you. Now, before we go to our announcements, I want to give our speaker an opportunity to come back and finish and close out her word. But you know what? It's okay that we are able to jump forward and have those people be saved. We want them to be saved in our kingdom, and that's okay. So we want her to come back and finish out the message. We want her to come back because the enemy is a defeated foe, and we want her to be able to finish what God has called her to do today. So join me in inviting Sister Reese back.
Thank you. This is just further confirmation that God is speaking and God had a word for you all today, because if there was an attack after attack and trying to come up with this and trying to seek the face of God for this message, this is just confirmation that God is working, and I'm going to continue to do what God told me to do because I ain't scared of no enemies. But I thank you all for sticking with us, and I thank you all for opening your hearts to salvation. Thank you, Ashley, for a powerful prayer. I am so thankful for you all. And so we're going to move forward into being the characteristics of being an intentional leader, because we got to finish this. So after fun, intentional leader is solution-oriented, and so when there are problems that arise, an intentional leader knows where to find a solution or knows how to jump in, attain a solution. And so it's important for us as followers of God to be solution oriented, because people are going to ask for solutions. So they're going to ask for, if this happens, how do I? And so we must go to the word and say, well, if this happens, you do this. And so solutions, they come from the word and they come from God. And so we must look to God for solutions. Also, we must be organized. Sometimes chaos will help people to lose the message. And so we don't want chaos because God is a God of order. And so when we're organizing, when we're orderly, God moves and God is pleased with us because we are doing things in his way and in his order. And so that kingdom come, that will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so heaven is not messy. Heaven is not disorganized. Earth is not messy either. And we are the ground keepers for that. And an intentional leader, and I put this in caps for a reason, pray. The word says resist the enemy and he will flee from you. If you pray, you will get everything that you need. Everything that you need is in God. And so if you're having a conversation with God consistently in your life, then you are aligned with what you need. And so you must pray. You must pray before you eat that piece of candy. I laugh because Sister Wise, Ashley, she always talk about praying before you eat a piece of candy. I don't know which one of her family members told her that, but I love that. Like, I love that so much. But it's important. You should pray before you do anything. You should pray before you leave out the door. I'm so thankful that my family has implemented prayer before we leave out of the door. My four-year-old, he is a prayer warrior, and I love that so much. But I realized that our families are lacking because we're not putting the importance of God in the forefront of our families. And so we must pray. We must teach our children that prayer is important, that prayer is necessary, conversation with God is necessary. And so moving forward, I just wanted to kind of gather some key points in closing. And I'm following from my laptop because I had to log back in from my phone. So forgive me if I'm looking crazy, but I'm just looking at my laptop. But we must be obedient. We must listen. We must be confident. We must speak up, be wise, strong, and pray to get to the promise and to help others too, because it's important for us to help others. Like, if we're selfish in the promise, that heart, that intent there is all wrong, and God's not going to be pleased. And you're going to be like, what? But I was a good person. What? But God, I did good by myself. But it's like, no, God asks you to do more, and God calls you to be an impact. And so also we must be intentional and be righteous. And so, yes, we are supposed to be good people. We are supposed to live righteous. So when we are in instances where we're not living righteous, or the seed that is coming forth is not showing that, we must repent and make sure that we are changing our actions, our ways, in order for the greater impact of God in the world. And so we also must have confidence that we can and will win, because it's God's will. Like, it's God's will that we will win. Like, literally in a few of the verses that we read in Joshua and in Psalms, it literally says that we will win if we do these things. If we follow the law, we will win. So that's in God's will, because it's already written, and God already said it, and God already ordained that for us. So we must make sure that we remember that. So we must be encouraged. We must hear the voice of the Lord. And hearing the voice of the Lord, we can't hesitate. We have to move. We have to be obedient. Also, we have to make sure that our hearts don't harden when life gets good or bad. Because actually, in the example with Pharaoh and the frogs, his heart hardened not when it was bad. When it was bad, he softened his heart and he reached out for God. And we do that all the time. It's like, oh my God, God, I'm so sorry. This is happening, but I'm so sorry. But when things are good, is our heart hardened for God? Like, when things are good, do we forget God? When things are good, do we forget to give God glory? Do we forget to even pray? Do we forget to even acknowledge? Do we forget to even read our word? So we have to remember to not let our heart harden when things are good, especially. We got to stay loyal. We always talking, and the world's always talking and preaching about being loyal, but are we loyal to Christ? Are we loyal to God for real? Like, because we could literally have somebody in our faith telling us that God is not real, that, you know, as Black people, we shouldn't be following Jesus and all these things. But are we confident in our hearts that we know the Lord for ourselves? we must be. We must stay loyal, and we must not allow our hearts to harden for God, or we must not allow confusion to take place in our hearts. So we must be the example, show someone who God is, and say what God tells you to say with boldness. The enemy did not want me to say this with boldness. The enemy wanted me to be weak today, but I come to you strong, stronger than I was the last time I brought forth a message. More faith, more confidence in God. And so I'm so grateful. I'm so thankful. But it's because I started to dive into the word. I've shared with people that since I became an intercessor, that's been my prayer. Like, Lord, please help me. What was the specific prayer? Grant me with the desire to read your word more, right? And I found an old book. I think it was like from 2016. And it was like, I wrote that down, like that was a prayer. Like that was a big thing for me, because I'm like, you know, just like all of us and those who are bathed in Christ and those who don't know the word like that, it's hard sometimes when you're reading, like for instance, in Romans, I had to look up who in the world Paul was talking to, because at first it seemed like a letter. And then it was like, but then it sounded like it was a conversation going back and forth. And I'm like, did I miss something? It was still a letter, but he was making sure he was considering all things. And so if you don't know, look it up. Get your context clues, but don't discount God and don't discount the word because it's confusing to you. And I'm going to end with this last, these last two slides with our Bible verses. But this one is Philippians 4:9, and it says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. So if you heard from God, do it, and peace will follow. It's so important to be obedient. It's so important to listen to God, but you cannot hear the voice of the Lord if you do not read your word. Read your word. And so this next slide is just really me sharing, giving y'all a hug and sharing God's heart for you. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Fear God, trust God, love God, hear God, read your word, and you will be an intentional leader for Christ. Amen. And be blessed. Thank you, Lord.
Amen, amen, amen. We're glad to have you back, Sister Charisse, and glad that you were able to finish out that word. We are so thankful that God used you in a mighty way this morning, and he used you because he knew that you had a word for us today. So we are so thankful that we were able to hear the word that you provided for us. And we pray right now in the name of Jesus that God gives it back to you 100-fold. Everything that you have poured out, your testimony, your bravery, your courageousness, your honesty, and your strength, we pray that God restores it back to you in the name of Jesus 100-fold. We thank you for that word this morning. How many of you were blessed this morning by that word? How many of you received it? We thank you that God used her in a mighty way, and God was able to give us a message and give us some points and some characteristics that we can apply in our daily life. So we thank God this morning. He ultimately gets all the praise and gets all the glory this morning. So we already have done our altar call, and we thank those that have been accepted, and we are excited about you being accepted into God's kingdom. So now we're asking if anyone needs prayer or partnership or salvation, please visit us at www.lbcbaltimore.org. We want to hear from you. We want to talk with you. We want to pray with you. You can also call us at 443-776-0255. Someone is waiting to receive your call. Someone is waiting to hear from you and to discuss with you and pray with you. And you can also email us at lbcministry@yahoo.com. So if you need prayer, partnership, or salvation, please reach out to us, because we have some people that are waiting to talk with you, our ministers and our pastors and our, our leadership, they're waiting and they're ready to talk to you. Amen. Amen. All right. So now we are going to get ready for opportunity time. It's opportunity time. We know we love to give. God loves a cheerful giver. And I believe that our opportunity declaration will be read by one of our youth. So let's encourage her as she comes forth. Ms. Fallon Wilcox.
Good morning. It's opportunity time. Life Builders Church has generous and faithful tithers and givers. Your generous giving adds value to this ministry. So now is your opportunity to continue your generosity in giving.
Amen. Amen. We are excited to give with Ms. Fallon. That was so beautifully read. Thank you so much, Ms. Fallon Wilcox. And we have multiple ways for you all to be able to give with us. You can give online at lbcbaltimore.org. You can also give via PayPal. You can go to www.paypal.me/lifebuilderschurch. And you can also go directly to paypal.com, the website, and you can search for us, lbcministry@yahoo.com. So we have multiple streams and we want you to be able to give. And you can also give by mail. You can mail it to Life Builders Church, Care Advantage, Inc., 100 West Road, Suite 300, Towson, Maryland, 21204. So we have, you can give online, you can give by mail, the old fashioned way. We still receive it and it's still used for God's kingdom and it's still used in a mighty way. All right, and now we will have our announcements that will be read by one of, that will be distributed by one of our other youth. His name is Mr. Jaden Maddox. Welcome forth, Mr. Jaden. Okay, we'll give Jaden just another second. Jaden, are you on? We know that there were some tech issues today. All right, well, let's keep moving forward. Today we have Pastor's Appreciation. Pastor's Appreciation drive-by today will be from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. It will be at 7310 Park Heights Avenue. We know that that is where we are worshiping at Har Sinai with Temple Oheb. So we want you to come out and celebrate and let's show our appreciation for all of our pastors, for our bishop and our first lady and Pastor Dolores. So we hope that you will join us today and come on out from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. It will be good to see some familiar faces and good to just be in the place and fellowship and, you know, just enjoy time with each other. Amen. Amen. All right. We also know that we have been volunteering for our food giveaways. If you are interested in volunteering, please use the QR code that is below and you can sign up. For those of you that have a smartphone, you know, whether it's an iPhone or an Android, most of the time you can just take your camera and put it on the QR code and that will allow you, it will take you directly to the link and you're able to sign up and you're able to be a part. And we're always looking for volunteers. So we definitely want you to come out and volunteer because God has been such a blessing to us. We want to be a blessing to other people. And they have plenty of items that they're giving away, you know, plenty of food items and just plenty of ways to be a blessing to the community and to others. So come on out and join us and sign up as we give away. All right. If you're also looking for free legal services, we want you to call this number, 443-451-2805, or you can email them at lawyer@mdlab.org. If you're looking for any legal services, whether it's custody or child support or, you know, consumer debt, bankruptcy, record expungement, you know, public benefits, in partnership with MedStar, we want you to make sure that you have the resources that you need. So please take advantage of this and call them today at 443-451-2805. All right, another blessing, another resource. If you're interested, We have a free virtual job training and resume writing workshop. You can learn to boost your resume and enhance your job skills. There are 3 Saturday sessions taking place November 6th, November 13th, and November 20th. And they will take place at 10 a.m. and you can pre-register through Eventbrite using the link below. This was offered in partnership with Desiree Johnson. She is our workshop instructor and facilitator, and she's partnering with LBC. So we want LBC to be in the place, and we want LBC to be represented well. So if you're interested in free virtual job training and resume writing workshop, amen, amen. All right, continuing with our Wednesday impact group discussions, we've had some powerful discussions, and we have some very powerful group facilitators. All participants are using one general code now, so we will all meet on the Google Meet using the code JQSCXKXQWR. And that's every Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. And we've had some really, really good discussions and really good engagement, you know, and just new perspectives and new ideas. So make sure you join us on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Amen. All right. And every morning from 6:15 to 6:30, we have our intercessory prayer. This has been going strong for so many years. Please join us. It's powerful impact prayer, and it is a great start to your morning. When you join us for prayer, I guarantee and I promise you, your day will be better. Join us with 605-475-4700. The access code is 585-263-POUND. And our intercessors, we are on the line. We're on the line interceding for LBC, interceding for all. So we want you to join us in prayer, 6:15 to 6:30, 15 minutes of powerful prayer every day. Amen. All right. So we have come to the end of our worship today. I don't know about you, but I am just so thankful and I'm so blessed. I'm appreciative of this word today. God used all of our youth and young adults in such a mighty way, in such a powerful way. And we continue to pray for those who are away, those who are away at school, those who may be working, those who are just out and about doing what God has called them to do. But this was such a wonderful worship today. I'm so glad and excited and I'm thankful. And I just feel refreshed and renewed to start my week. And I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Ty. He's going to close us out.
Thank you for worshiping with us. God dwells in the midst of Life Builders Church. God dwells in the midst of a blessed community. Grace and peace be unto you. Peace be multiplied.